But I changed when I walked out of that place. And I was a different person. There were no boundaries for me anymore. And I had a hole in my heart that couldn't be filled by overachievement. It couldn't be filled by drugs or by relationships. And I suffered for 10 years trying to fill that up with something. In 1983, I had just graduated from college, and I considered that my condition in life was stable enough that I could go ahead and have a child. But I had felt so betrayed by men in my life that I never wanted to have a husband. I just wanted to have a child. I wanted that hole filled up, and I didn't know yet that it was only Jesus that could fill it up. And so I carried that child for about 4 months, and I took classes, and I decided that I could do this thing. But one day, I just woke up and fear came upon me. You see, there's a spirit of death that brings fear, and that was attached to me since my abortion in 1973. And it plagued me no matter what I did. It was the curse, every curse of the law that's written in this book. And it entrapped me so that I couldn't turn. There was nowhere to go above and nowhere to go below, because I was bound to a spirit of death. And so one day when I woke up in fear, I said, what am I doing? I must be crazy. I can't do this thing. I called my obstetrician that had been giving me prenatal care, and I told him I changed my mind. I wanted to have an abortion. He never asked me a question. He just made the phone call and made an appointment for me in a local hospital the next morning. So I went, and I went under sedation, and the thing was done. But when I woke up from that abortion, I had been involved in witchcraft and Satanism in San Francisco, and I had one of my friends who was sitting beside the bed who was also involved in that with me. And I looked at her and I said, Daphne, I just killed my baby. And she said, no, that wasn't what it was. You weren't supposed to. Don't think of it like that. And so, again, I'm to repress this deep, dark secret. And I became more and more angry and more hurt. And from that point on, my life just took a plunge. I had 2 subsequent abortions after that. I lost everything that I had. I got really heavy into drugs. And when it got to the point where my cocaine habit was about $1,000 a week, and I still couldn't kill the pain, I went and I looked into a mirror one day, and I looked in my eyes for some kind of answer, and I was calling out to some kind of God that I didn't even know. And I saw the power that was in my eyeballs that was greater than me. It was greater than me. And I knew it was trying to take me down, and there was no escape. And I wanted to just lay down and die. I wanted to embrace death as my friend, because it had embraced me for so many years. And so I got my crack pipe and my bottle of Jack Daniels, my closest friends. And I slit my wrist, and I got in a pool of water, which began to fill up with my own blood. And I don't know why I'm alive today, except that when I was 15, I called upon the name of the Lord. And I said, Lord, save me, because I'm a sinner. And I was in a little Baptist church where they were playing Just As I Am. And it was just a little incident one day for me. And that's all it lasted. And I never followed Jesus after that. That little 15-year-old who went down to that altar and made that commitment to Christ honored his covenant with me. Though I had no idea what it meant. And when I was faithless, he remained faithful, because he couldn't deny himself. His blood was mingled with my blood in a covenant relationship that I didn't even know I had. And so when I slit my wrist and the blood flowed from me, my blood cried out to Jesus, just like the blood of Abel that cried out from the land. And Jesus heard my blood, and he came to save me. And there was a light that came in that bathroom overlooking the San Francisco Bay that night. And I to this day proclaim that that was Jesus. It was Jesus. It was Jesus who delivered me. He came to get me because his arm was not short. His arm is not short to save America. Though our land be drenched in blood, it cries out to him. It cries out to him. And we know God's character from this word. And the word that was given forth this morning in Leviticus 18 says that, and thou shalt not let any of thy seed pass through the fire to Molech, neither shalt thou profane the name of the Lord thy God. I am the Lord. And he goes on to say, and the land is defiled. America's land is defiled. It is a physical thing entrenched with spirits, spirits of death. And the land defiled, therefore I do visit the iniquity thereof upon it. And the land itself vomiteth out her inhabitants. And I say that there is a spiritual vomiting taking place. It is not a slow leak. It is a vomit that is coming forth, and it is souls that have been bound by the spirit of death. And the Lord Jesus is pouring out his mercy and grace to release those who have been held by death. For the covenant of Jesus Christ will break the covenant of death, and his agreements with Sheol will be annulled. Yeah.